the first time he's ever conceded anything. thank you so very, very much for the kind words that you have said. Last Friday, there was a huge op-ed.
Oh yes.
Now I'm a budding writer as well. I want to assure you, I'm really not jealous. It was wonderful. I mean that. You could get that kind of spread at this particular time. Why? Why do you think they wanted to publish you in that fashion?
I think there's no doubt in my own mind that many millions of South Africans are deeply troubled about the situation that we find ourselves in. And the question I pose, what's gone wrong, is being asked by many, many people around the country. And I think the newspapers are aware of what's happening and are listening, hopefully, to people. So I suppose they decided to publish the extract because it's newsworthy. And I think it is newsworthy from a point of view that there are so many things that have gone wrong and many of us don't understand why and how it's happened. So I think that's why they published the extract, and I hope they'll publish lots more.
Yes. You wouldn't want to concur with me that we made an awful mistake. You recall that during the time of the struggle, internally, those who are now called insiders were almost obsessed with the whole notion of mandate.
Yes.
You know, discussing things. You might recall that we had a massive march in September 1989 called by Alan Broussard. And me. And when we told the people, Sharon Carolus came up to me and said, "Where did you get the mending?" Well, and I said, I mean, I think I shut her up when I said, "Come on." But the point I want to make is that there was almost an obsession with discussions and ensuring that everyone was on board who should be on board, and then when the exile arrived, did you notice the insiders stepped back? we, almost all of us, has been handed over to them. So in a way, would you think you wanted to agree? Do you know that? I mean, I have a hotline to...
Yes, yes.
So would you think that we made a tactical mistake?
Your Grace, I think the mistake was not made by us. The mistake was made by those who came from outside, the ANC in exile. And it reflected the authoritarian spirit which dominated the debate within the exile community. And they didn't like the UDF very much, because it was an internal movement, really part of the ANC, but they couldn't declare that they were ANC, otherwise they had to go straight to jail. But I think that the emphasis in the exiled movement was one-party state, a determination to control, and that has washed over us now. And unfortunately, where the mistake was made, that people in the leadership of the UDF, instead of standing up against that,
yes,
and retaining the role that they were playing, which was a magnificent role, as you say, just stepped back and allowed the people who came in from the outside, and bear in mind that they had 30 years in exile, yes, and they had developed a culture of deep suspicion of anyone who wasn't exactly in step with them. And understandably, there were many spies, there were many informers. It was a tough, tough time. And I think they brought that commitment to the seizure of power back home. And regrettably, it is my view that within the ANC leadership, that commitment of the seizure of power by all means is still there, even though they have almost unlimited power as government.
Yes.
I wanted to throw a tiny spanner.
As long as it's tiny.
No. As you have, I too met with the leadership outside. Mm-hmm. Particularly, I mean, someone I think was incredible, Oliver Tambo.
Absolutely.
It was quite touching, in fact. I said I wanted to meet him. And the then Archbishop of Canterbury said, Lambeth Palace is available for you. If you want to meet, you can come and meet there. And you know, O.R. sent a message to me to say, was I sure that I wanted to meet him? Wasn't I scared of the repercussions when I returned? And am I wholly wrong to think, I mean, that your characterization of them, when you've got someone like him,
yeah,
that characterization is not entirely accurate?
Yes, I would agree. I was very fortunate. I only met Oliver Tambo once. And as I say in the book, I was very surprised. I cannot remember if it was lunch or dinner, but before we could start, he said, I want us to say grace. Now, for someone in exile and the head of a so-called terrorist organization, this was quite a revelation. But I've looked very carefully at the 30 years in exile, And Oliver Tambo was a remarkable man.
Yes.
He must have had such mixed emotions. As you know, he wanted to train as an Anglican priest.
Yes.
And for the sake of the movement, of the struggle, he was acting in place of Mandela, who was in prison. But those were really very horrendous days. People were constantly in danger. And there was also a great difficulty in maintaining discipline, as we know. And how he held that movement together was almost like a miracle. And I don't think sufficient tribute has been given to Oliver Tambo, and so I take your point entirely. When I talk about the ANC in exile, it's as a group, but there are very strong exceptions, including somebody like Chris Hani, for example.
Yes. I'm very sad, you know, as I sit here, I think you and many have a deep sadness. I remember one occasion with Oliver when we had a Eucharist. Mm-hmm. We met and I said, yes, before we have this meeting, let's have Holy Communion. And Tabu was then his assistant, and he didn't attend. He went to walk outside, up and down the street in London, puffing away at his and I think you are right, but I don't want to believe that you are right.
That's why I didn't want to write the book.
Yes, I mean, I was quite sad, you know, looking after our euphoria.
Yes.
You know, when I introduced Madiba to South Africa and to the world as our newly elected, democratically elected president, I said to God, look here, God, really, I don't mind if I die now. It would be wonderful. I mean, it would be a wonderful time. We've reached a peak, yes.
Yeah.
And then, yes, I said to somebody very, very close to the ANC, I said to her, you know, we seem to have reached the point that was reached by the Nets.
Yeah.
That is, they don't ask, what is your qualification? What are you able really to do? What have you been trained for? The first question is, the Nets would say, what is your political affiliation? And this person said to me, no. And I was taken aback for a little while and said, no, it's not that way. It's worse. And I said, really? Yes, and said, now they ask, to what faction do you belong? What faction do you... Now, I don't know about you, my friend. You know you caused me to cry.
Yes.
At the TRC. And there are many moments when I weep. I weep for our land.
Right.
Because this is in fact one of the most fantastic countries in the world. And I'm not I'm not sort of trying to cheer myself up. It really is. You know, I mean, you think, by the way, there was a time when police climbed trees and peeped through bedrooms to check whether there was sex between their, and they even jumped into the room to check out the temperature of the sheets. And now you see someone pushing a pram with a baby of indeterminate hue. You know, I mean, I still, even today, stand when I see couples in a clinch, you can't even get a razor blade between them. and the sky remains firmly in place. You look at schools. I mean, we live in Milnerton, which used to be a very cramped place. The high school. You watch at break, and you see kids representing the whole spectrum of our. Yes, what has gone wrong? When we have paradise within our grasp.
Yeah.
Well, you'll say, read my book.
Well, I agree with you that those first 5 years after President Mandela took over the highest office in the land, those were the golden years. And I concede immediately that the ANC did some very, very wonderful things during those years, led by Mandela and his total commitment to humanity. He really loved us, and we loved him, as you know, and you loved him probably more than most because you were so close. But as the years went by, something of the magic of the leadership was dissipated, and you began to see self-enrichment in place of service. You saw people disregarding the rule of law, and nobody seems to be punished. If you go to jail, you go straight to hospital. You don't pass go, you just go straight to hospital. And once you're out of hospital, you play golf. So even though you're supposed to be dead. And it's this kind of lack of administration of justice. And you talk about the wonder of seeing a school where black and white kids are sitting together. That's absolutely true. But we also know that there are terrible situations where there are no science laboratories, where there's no sports fields, where in some instances there are no toilets. So after 20 years of rule,
yes,
we are in a situation where the country's fabric is breaking down. And I've used the phrase which is a disputed phrase, and that is a failing state. And if you look, if I can just mention a couple of examples, if you look at the executive, which is the very head of the country, you don't know quite who is running the country. You don't quite know who is that executive any longer. It's more Lutuli House. It's more the party rather than the state. And that distinction has been blurred. If you take a look at Parliament, the ANC is determined that every one of its members of parliament will adhere to ANC constitution, not to the constitution. And that's in black and white. And it's in the book. So it's all there. If you take the constitutional court, this is one of the greatest possessions of our country.
Yeah.
But if you listen to what Mantashe says, and this is not just anyone, it's him as the general secretary of the ANC saying that this is at, if they touch us, we are at war. And Zuma echoes those words, and again, I've quoted them, so I won't bother to read them. One could go on and on. The institutions of state are there. We are very lucky about that. You've got the public prosecutor. You've got the auditor general. But they're failing in bringing this government to account. And that's what is needed, to bring the country and its rulers to account, so that that spirit of democracy that you referred to earlier on, when you had that march, where consensus was sought, where opinions were sought after, that's no longer the case. The decisions are taken, and if you're a friend of the ANC, if you're a relative of the ANC, if you are linked with the ANC, you get a job, despite your lack of credentials or merit. And that means that the poorest of the poor are suffering, because the resources that should be made available at local government, which is where all government really starts, it's face to face. And people are either spiriting away the money, or they're maladministrating the money. Auditor General says, every time I look at the accounts and I tell them there's no accounting in your report, they go back and they do exactly the same thing. So we've got the institutions of state in place. But what I'm suggesting is that liberty, the price of liberty, as someone once put it, is eternal vigilance.
Yes.
And we ought to be much more vigilant about the direction that South Africa is going. Because in my view, if we continue in the same line, in the same road, we'll be going downhill and not uphill where we belong, where we can see the sun shining, we can be at peace with one another and with the world. And I just feel that that warning should be heeded, that it could become worse unless we take a stand. And that's why I asked the question, what's gone wrong and how do we try and put it right?
Now, how do you get to respond to the critique? Well, one, because he's a white liberal.
Yeah.
Wait, I've not finished.
Oh, no, I'm listening very carefully.
Yes. And in a way, unpatriotic.
Yeah. Yeah.
What can he say?
Well, patriotism is the last resort of the scoundrels.
I thought you were looking for a chance to use that.
Well, you were right. No, look, I accept that there are people who are very critical of, and while the response has been very warm and encouraging, I'm sure that they're going to be critics, particularly from those who feel that I've painted too dark a picture.
Yeah.
And they say it's all very well for this white liberal or whatever other name one wants to call me, and I don't really bother about names. They can say what they like. I think one has to tell the truth as we see it.
Yeah.
I mean, this is what you've done. More than anyone else in South Africa, you've told the truth for justice at a great considerable cost to yourself. What I'm saying is that the example that you have set ought to be followed by all of us. That we have to start risking a little bit more than we've been willing to do, because the country is in trouble. And let's say, for example, that we have an election, I assume, on May the 7th, and Jacob Zuma is returned as president. It may well be that following that, the ANC itself may become so embarrassed by the inept leadership and corrupt leadership, allegedly, that they decide to give him the boot that they gave Thabo Mbeki. And then it may be that somebody of the caliber of Cyril Ramaphosa takes over as president, or somebody like that, perhaps the former Mrs. Zuma or Mkhize from Mkhize. Okay, I got it right. Now, it may be.
Who told me?
Now, what I'm trying to get at is the critical question is, can the ANC be reformed from within?
Yeah.
Can the leopard change its spots? And even no matter who takes over from Zuma, the real question is not about leadership, it's about state institutions which are in peril. And I don't think the ANC can change its spots. It's very spotty. And I don't think that can change that. And therefore, what we need is not a united opposition. I mean, I'm so tired of these people constantly saying, let's all get together. And then you've got about 20% of the population. That's not going to help. What we need is a new coalition of forces, which includes a lot of people in the ANC now. And there are many, many good people in the ANC. You know them, I know them, and many I don't know. But I know that they must be constantly embarrassed when they pick up the newspapers or they listen to the radio or watch their television and see the mess that their leadership is making in this country. Now, if we could in some way bring together those who belong together in a coalition, which is not just a few little opposition parties, but including a big chunk of the ANC, then we're cooking with gas, as they say. Then we can really move. And I just think that that is possible, but it has to be worked for. You can't set the goal as let's unite the opposition. The goal has to be a new coalition of like-minded people who believe in truth, believe in justice, believe in peace.
Yes. Yes. I sitting here and listening to, I mean, I know you.
Mm-hmm.
And I know your caliber. I hope I've forgotten now what I've said in the foreword.
Brilliant foreword.
No,
well, strong forward.
What did I say about you?
Oh, you went on a big rave.
No. But you know, Alex, it is important to speak about patriotism. You said it is the refuge of
the last refuge of a scoundrel.
But I mean, one of the criticisms that you are sure to get is he's white. I mean, which is a very great disadvantage. he's a liberal, and he really doesn't care for the country very much.
Well, I have to respond to people who think that I've written this book because I care about the country. I care very much about the promise that we had, which has not been fulfilled.
Yes.
The lack of delivery. I mean, you know, let me just quote once something very short as to what the ANC stood for when they first came into power. This is what they said. No political democracy can survive and flourish if the mass of our people remain in poverty, without land, without tangible prospect for a better life. Attacking poverty and deprivation must therefore be the first priority of a democratic government. That was the reconstruction and development program which was abandoned very soon after these incredible words. If government committed itself to this, and I, as a caring South African, I could live anywhere I like. I want to live here. This is my country. And I belong here. And I believe I'm an African first and foremost an African, no matter what other people might say about skin color or political persuasion. I'm an African, and I'm distressed to see the country going downhill instead of moving forward and caring for the poorest of the poor.
I think that one of the things that I wanted to underscore was precisely this, that you left after the TRC. In fact, I had suggested that you were given a diplomatic posting to one or other of the major. I thought that would be the very least that could have been done by a country that was saying thank you. Because although I get very considerable kudos for having been the chair of the Truth and Reconciliation Commission, if the truth be told, we would not have started at the time we did without you. You were an amazing second in command. You were an incredible administrator. For we started out with absolutely nothing. Right. It was just us. And you had to get us offices. You had to employ people who were going to be our aides. And when that posting didn't come, you went abroad and founded the International Center for Transitional Justice,
right,
which is almost one of its kind. I mean, everybody in the different countries that have had strife in their recent history were rushing to have you and your colleagues. And you were a professor.
Yeah.
The University of New York. If anyone really questioned, you want to say, I could actually go anywhere. I have proven it. I have come back, and I would want to thank you. I want to thank you as someone who's been very close to you at a very, very testing time. I get the praise, maybe because they know I cannot blush. but it is you and all of the other colleagues that we have. And it brings me to say one of the major recommendations we made was the gap between the rich and the poor,
right,
we said, should be narrowed dramatically, quickly.
Right.
Otherwise, we can kiss reconciliation goodbye.
Yeah.
Well, we were accused of criminalizing the struggle. We were taken, we had to go to court. Wow. South Africa has now become
the country with the widest gap between rich and poor, and the delivery protests are a confirmation of the things that you said then as part of our group and the things that you're saying now. And this old man wants to say again on behalf of our country, thank you, Alex, for being you. Really lousy. I mean, I think that Alex deserves a standing ovation. Give him that standing ovation.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
A streak in me of the dictator.
Only a streak. Can I respond to what you have said so generously? First of all, I'm delighted that the diplomatic post was not offered. It's not something that I think I would have done well, and I prefer to be more active, more direct, rather than diplomatic. But thank you for trying. It's very interesting that they refused. And they'd refuse now more than ever. But second, you know, there's no question that without your leadership, the TRC would never have done what it did. You were the right person at the right time, at the right place. No.
We are a mutual admiration society.
No. I don't see. Yeah, I can see you are blushing. But no, we owe a great deal to our colleagues and our team. You're absolutely right. One of the strongest recommendations we made was to work towards economic justice. Yeah. And we made it, spelt it out so clearly. And the ANC leadership simply didn't hear that. And despite our entreaties, by you, by me, by others, on television, on radio, in print, writing directly to the then President Mbeki, we got nowhere at all. I mean, we actually recommended that there should be a once-off wealth tax so that every one of us could make a contribution to help narrow that gap. But that was totally disregarded and misunderstood, incidentally, as well, as though it was going to be a wealth tax forever and a day. It was never seen that that was a German example are in post-war Germany, where they introduced a wealth tax for once and once only. And it would have made a difference. It would have maintained the momentum towards reconciliation, which I think we've lost. And not forever, because if there's one thing I strongly stand for, is that there is no place for despair. There's no room for saying, well, what the hell, it's no word fighting for a good cause. These people are in charge. Let them just take the country where they are. If we all took that stand, the country would go to hell in a basket very, very soon. And it doesn't have to. It really doesn't have to. There are ways and means. For example, if we had a people's parliament, by that I mean members of parliament who represented a particular constituency and were accountable to that constituency. So you can say he and she, they are my MPs, and I demand of them that they report back. I was in an awful parliament. It was non-representative, unrepresentative in many ways. It was all white. But the constituency I had in Pinelands and Rondebosch demanded that I had answered to them, which I tried to do. And I think that's one thing we can learn from the old days. But I must say, Your Grace, when I started writing this book, I revisited Parliament for the first time. I never wanted to go back. But I was thrilled to go back and see from the gallery this array of so many women, because we hardly had any women in the Parliament when I was there. So many black and brown and all shades of the rainbow in that Parliament, and it looked so good. So, and then I watched as they nodded off, and I realized that it was a very human, imperfect model. But then I went to the committee stages, and they're much better than ours was. There they could debate the issues, but I noticed again, three or four people knew what was happening, the rest just were passengers or were critical. And I just realized that we've missed at such an opportunity in the institutions of state, which are at our disposal. And we've made, I mean, you know what one leading ANC member said to me when I was interviewing him? He said two things. One, he said, I find it difficult when I stand up to speak in Parliament. This is a leading member of the ANC, because on the one hand, I try to listen to my conscience. On the other hand, I have to listen to what my party tells me to do. Can you imagine the clash, the awful situation? But he went further and he said, you know, my party is now sending the worst of the group, the mediocre group, to Parliament because they can't make much money there. I mean, what a devastating, that's an indictment by a black ANC member, not by this so-called white guy. He's admitting that people in the party go to where the money is and not where the service is. And those are the sort of changes that we need to make, amendments to the Electoral Act, so that we can have a truly people's parliament. And it is possible, you know, if only we had the will and the guts to strive. And the book doesn't say, oh, well, all is lost. The book says, we're in trouble, let's try and fix it.
Did you read Max Dupree this morning? About failed states.
Right.
You reckon he is concurring with you?
No, I think he's definitely disagreeing with me very strongly. And I read it very carefully because Max is a great friend and a great colleague and a very fine journalist. But I totally disagree with him. No, I'll put it this way. He was 50% right.
Yes.
We are not a failed state. And nothing in this book suggests that we are. What I'm saying is that we are failing, and that if we continue to fail, we're going to reap the consequences of it. I mean, I'm staggered by some of the remarks that he made. I was just jotting down. I just happened to have it in my hand here. I was just saying, you know.
Oh, Alan, you used to be a minister of the cloth.
Yeah, but that's a very long time ago. No, I mean, Max Dupree, who should know better, says, we have, amongst other things, a free, independent, and diverse media. Well, I don't know if he's heard of Iqbal Serte at all. But I have, and the press in this country is in trouble. The television is slanted. The radio is, SABC is in a mess. And, you know, we've got to face, it's no good pretending that all is well and showing peace, peace where there's no peace. And there's the clergyman coming out, straight from the prophets. Peace, peace where there is no peace. And I mean, I just feel you've got to tell it like it is. And it's a troubled country, but with incredible potential and wonderful people. And we've got to tap into that and make it work.
Yeah. Well, you know, I had imagined that we oldies would have been standing on the sidelines cheering on our successors, our children, our grandchildren, cheering them on as we went from one achievement to another, almost inexorably. And it is a great ache.
Yeah.
It's a great ache. Because as I said in passing earlier, we have incredible people in this country, of all races, people who are committed to this land. I mean, I just think of the people who could have left, professionals, who could have left and been snapped up in some of the fantastic people you have as professors, and especially in medicine,
right?
People who could go anywhere in the world and they would be just grabbed. And it is a great ache. And I hope, Alex, that book will not be dismissed as, what did you expect? I think it is important. And I think I said a little bit of that in the foreword. It is important for people to know just how passionately you love this country, and that you want to see this country reach the potential that it has. It is up to us. It is up to us. Up to us. It is up to us not to allow our country to go to the dogs. It is up to us. It is up to us to say it is a total nonsense to say children have passed who get 30%. It is an insult. It's an insult to us, to those children, that we should be saying, when we know that when many of them are given opportunities, they soar. And it is in a sense we who hold back the incredible potential that there is in this beautiful land. We may not be going to be the most affluent, though we should have most people being comfortable. But I mean, it is a great aid for me to say that they the house, the apartheid house I lived in with my parents was a great deal better than the RDP. Of course, they've got some beautiful things that we've got to, I mean, the along the N2, as you go to the airport on the left. when you leave the airport and you look on the left,
oh boy,
then you see again, what have we done? Why have we allowed this? It is up to us to ensure that this land is the land that God wants it to be. For it has got you, beautiful people. Aided and abetted by people like Alex. Thank you. Bye bye. Well,
just a few. Can you ask a few questions from the floor? Would you want to moderate it? Yeah.
Yes, since you are a professor.
Just a few. Yes, you've got to have questions.
Hello. Who would like to ask a question from the floor?
Yeah, yeah.
Do you have a microphone to take to them, or do you need to take this one? Okay.
Evening. So my name's Anthony Silverberg. First of all, I'd like to thank you for a very entertaining presentation. You're a superb orator. Can always keep people entertained. Thank you very much. I noticed that your book is only 130 pages. Is that because you can't find anything wrong, really? I would have thought you would be able to write 1,000 pages on what went wrong. Just for example, now you for instance, you don't mention anything about how sort of racist South Africa has become. I think it's become more racist now than it was under the old regime. Sure, we can sit on the same park bench, but now everything's measured in terms of black and white and this here. And I think that's wrong. We're getting the wrong people in jobs here. And that's why organizations are failing, from South African Airways, SABC, ESCOM. Nothing is working right. And that's one of the main problems, because if those things don't work, the country can't work properly. Sure. And I've just come back from Australia. And it was so refreshing to see there that no one cares whether you're black or white or anything. People just get down and do a job. And that's why the sort of economy in Australia is three times the size of South Africa. Because nothing is separated into pockets like we always do here. And I think what we need to do is leadership to get us all working together like a good football team that we can go out and get some runs. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
I think you're right. But first, let me say that when I first saw Jonathan Ball with a four-page proposal for a book, he, thank goodness, approved it, and then said, but now keep it short and keep it anecdotal. So I've tried very hard to listen to my publisher and not write a tome which nobody's going to read. It's actually a bit more than 130 pages, but every page is worth reading. So,
quite right.
On a more serious note, I couldn't agree with you more. I think racism is a very present evil in our society, and whenever you criticize those in power, they play the race card, because they, and as the Archbishop has referred to, people will say, oh, he's white, and that's why he's saying the things he's saying. I'm not saying the things saying, I'm just holding up a mirror to the government, and that's what they're seeing reflected in this book. And if they don't like it, they ought to change.
A question over there, and then one over here, and then one over there, and then one over there.
Thank you, Professor. It's quite sad Because when I was sitting down, I was very, very uncomfortable with the assertions you made about the country. I differ with them very fundamentally, so completely, in fact. I'm Andile from the Eastern Cape. My father was in exile. And my grandfather, if perhaps Ash, you would remember, he was a reverend at the Diocese of St. John's in Mthatha. I can confirm perhaps that I am a child of ANC, if that's what you said. Critically to what I differ with you about is that you seem to put the fault of what is happening in this country only to our government. You have, like many of the people, perhaps because even the audience that you are talking to seems to agree with you, you seem to be suffering the same thing that many white South Africans are suffering from. The fact that they now, today, have made apartheid an orphan. Nobody wants to own it. Nobody wants to align himself or herself with. And an average 45-year-old was obviously living during that time and embracing and policing apartheid. Now, what you are saying, unfortunately, I'm a university graduate, and I see a very prosperous South Africa. I'm an entrepreneur, a serial entrepreneur, with investment company that owns businesses in three sectors, ICT, tourism, and agro-processing. And I happen to do business with whites in this Cape Town. And I chose to live in Cape Town instead of Joburg, because I knew that there's more whites in Cape Town that would still need to partner with a black guy than in Joburg. Now, the picture you are portraying, you seem to think that the responsibility of our failures and faults lies with the ANC government, particularly on the issue of economic transition. Yet you have whites that we have to push and press every day to transform, to accept affirmative action, to equitably distribute the wealth. I play no allegiance to the ANC. I believe in my credentials and capabilities. But I can assure you that, if contrary to what you believe in, the future of this country is very bright. We have taken responsibility as young leaders and businessmen in this country to move this country forward. It is in our own hands. I thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Saskia, there's one here, and then you had one over there and one over there. Thank you for your extreme ability.
Thank you. As one of these students that used to get arrested outside Wits, I challenge, well, I'm hoping that that Bishop Tutu will write the book called What's Gone Right? A lot has gone right. I protested for, and I stand for, a constitution that's holding its own. It's tough. We're putting it under stress. But I would remind you about the French Revolution. Revolution doesn't happen in one wave. It happens in at least three. And we are only on the second. The people who stand up and burn the furniture are essential, but they don't lead. They're not administrators. You have to have it fall back, like the tide, like a wave, and it comes back again, this time with slightly better administrators. And then on the third wave, you come back with the nerds and the bureaucrats, and we start the whole cycle again. But we have not finished writing our story. And when it comes to a lot of the criticisms, I'd like to say, we taught them well. We taught them about racism, about prejudice, about buggering up the SABC. God knows we taught them well. But we are coming right. We have a public protector that we could stand on Margaret Thatcher's shoulders. We have got a lot going.
going. I salute you. I agree with you. But I would like you to say you will stand and speak against a blind democracy. We need a decent black opposition party in this country. Who's going to do it? Because it's not the whites in this room. So let's stand up, hold fast, believe in the Constitution we fought so hard for, and go forward. We are in a better position than a lot of other countries. Thank you.
Thank you for that.
Jonathan.
Saskia, Jonathan. Just time for a few more.
Can I just reply very briefly
to the
last two questions? First of all, when I talk about racism, I'm not talking about black racism or white racism. I'm talking about racism. And I think you're absolutely right. We have taught people well. We, as white people, without beating our breasts, are a very racist society. And we blindly, most of us, the vast majority of whites, supported apartheid by voting for the National Party government in one year, one election after another, giving them a bigger and bigger advantage. So there's no quarrel about that. All I'm saying is that racism doesn't belong to one group or another. It is a pernicious problem which has to be sorted out by all of us together and acknowledging that we have made huge mistakes in the past. One of the stories I tell in my book is of a group of people coming to me on the eve of our election in 1994 and saying, please can we stay in your house because we're terribly worried because the blacks are going to do what we have done to them for so long. And they've stored water and food up on Table Mountain. I mean, that's how bad it was then. I also agree, finally, that you're absolutely right, that not everything is wrong, not everything is bad, but there are very real, basic, fundamental problems in our society, and we cannot ignore them.
Thank you, Alex. There's one on the far side of the room and one right here, and time is short. Will you take the one on the far side, and then we'll come right here for the next question? Is that okay? They've got one. Thank you.
Sorry, I'll be brief. I hear a lot of what we're saying about how we need to stand up and we need to come up with a party that people can follow. And personally, as a young South African, I was not personally affected by apartheid. I was not hurt by it. I was not disadvantaged by it. I know my parents were. So I don't have this anger and aggression towards the regime that was. But at the same time, I don't know how to stand up and say, how do we put this party together that we can all follow and we can all believe in? How do we remove this disillusionment? So many of my peers will not vote because there are no options that they can believe in, you know? And I want to do more, but I don't know how.
Sure.
Thank you very much.
Do you want to take the last? Is that the last question?
No, there's one more over here.
Okay.
Thank you. I actually do have a question.
Good. that's a nice change.
I'd like to ask whether you and Archbishop Tutu don't take some responsibility for what has gone wrong. When the TRC defined, you concentrated on the gross violation of human rights, and you defined that basically as killing people. But isn't the grossest, the most obscene thing that happened in this country the imposition of a poor education system to shackle generations of children that we are still living with? You touched on it with your 30% pass, but that is the effect that we're still living with. Didn't you lose the plot there?
Go ahead.
Yes. No. Very straightforwardly, we could do only what the TRC legislation allowed us. For one thing, you know, we were told what the limits would be. I mean, how far back you go and how far forward. No. Sorry. No. I mean, many times, I mean, we would have wanted to have said we need to look at this, that, and the other. But the legislation says specifically gross violations. And we did, in fact, try by having people come to tell their story, you know, to try to help in the healing.
I'm sorry, but you restricted gross violations.
We couldn't. No. I mean, because we were taken to court right at the beginning. I mean, there were people who were saying, no, they don't want this thing. And we were very fortunate, I think, in many ways, that the Constitutional Court found in our favor. But, I mean, we were set quite specific boundaries, you know. We would have, in a way, of course, we could have said forever. You know, when you look at the specifics, boundary education. Why should they have worried about anything else? I mean, so boundary education clobbered us thoroughly, you know, and as you say, we're still trying to recover. And I mean, we couldn't call people and say, now what specific thing did you lose? I think we tried. I mean, in some of the ways that we spoke about what was happening, that this limitation that you have given us doesn't really speak to the damage that apartheid did to our psyches. But we have to say that the TRC did do something. And if we hadn't had a president who was hostile to the TRC, there would have been a great deal more that had happened that was healing. I mean, one of our recommendations was that we should grant a reparation to all of the people who were recognized, deemed to be victims. What was it, 26?
Yeah.
26,000 rand a year for 6 years.
Right.
Do you know what happened? We said 26,000, which was piffling for a period of 6 years. People who had come to the TRC, some of them died before the parliament passed legislation that granted 30,000 as a once-off payment. I mean, that was cutting our recommendations. I mean, if we had a Madiba go with us, someone like him, it would have been slightly different. So don't blame us.
Can I just...
Alex, do you want...
Just a very brief comment. I think your question is well taken. The TRC was an imperfect instrument. It made many mistakes. But it was, as the Archbishop has made very clear, we had legislation passed by Parliament and we had to adhere to that. But we invited people to come if they had any recommendations in any field. And we had a number of people who were very vitally interested in education. And they came, and their documents, and Charles Villavicencio, who was our research director, will tell you that in the archives, we have documents of recommendations in light of education, of housing, of a number of issues which we made available. So we tried to go to the very borders of what we were supposed to be doing, even though the legislation didn't allow for that to have people coming over and over again. But I take your point, and I think if some of our many, many pages of recommendations had been accepted by government, we'd be in a very different situation right now. I think, as I said earlier, we've lost the momentum. I just want to say to that young woman who spoke just a moment ago, we're not ignoring, I hear what you're saying, and this is the dilemma. First of all, a lot of people don't know who on earth to vote for anymore, but vote you must if you can. It's too precious. We have an archbishop here who, I don't know how old, he's very old now, but but he was an old man when he voted for the first time. That's how precious the vote is. We must vote. And we have to take the least worst sometimes rather than not vote at all. And as young people, I just think really the future is not with the archbishop or me. The future is with you. And you must grab it and find ways of fulfilling the hope that you have with other young people. Now, can I just say one last thing?
Hey, please do.
Not a question. I just want to say a very quick thank you. First of all, I would like to say a thank you to you.
Thank you.
For publishing the book. You made a very, very good decision. And but I want to, quite seriously, thank you and your staff. It's been a marvelous. And Andrea, who's sitting in front, absolutely amazing, the way they've cared for us as I go from place to place to place. I want to thank the Archbishop for his foreword. Please read that. It is strong. It is powerful. It's worth reading. But I want to thank him not only for that, but just being here tonight. I mean, this man has so many demands on his time that you can't believe it. And I'm just so honored that you found time to be with us tonight. And I want to thank you very much indeed. And thank everyone who... No author writes on his own. So anybody who's helped and inspired or just made it possible for this to be done, thank you very much indeed.
Thank you, Alex.